This is the part where I can talk about what I hope to see in upcoming games. A lot of it will be repeated from my old video on this subject, only hopefully this video will have clearer examples. Firstly, in my 2008 video, I was hoping for an increase in parallax mapping in games. Well, forget I said that. It has been replaced with another, better and far simpler solution. Tessellation! This is effectively just increasing the number of triangles things are made out of as you get closer to them, which gives the impression of more detail. If you had infinite processing power, this could replace things such as bump mapping. In fact, rendering everything in 3D in the first place is how they generate the bump maps for characters in the first place. But for now, a blend of the two is the most efficient way to go. I hope that movement gets a once-over in games. Rockstar seem to be the only ones capable of really fluid animations at the moment. Check out Grand Theft Auto 4 and Max Payne 3, both using Euphoria's animation system, which can combine animations and let the computer go freestyle if it needs to. For example, if you decide to make Max jump headfirst into a concrete pillar. We're beginning to see decent physics being implemented into new games. Borderlands 2 has tons of debris, rippable cloth and real-time liquid thrown in thanks to Nvidia's PhysX. But an open source alternative for both Nvidia and AMD to use is needed if these effects are to be included for more than just visual purposes in game. After trying out 3D, I like the idea, but it's still poorly supported in most games. It does well in games where the action goes on up close, like in Portal, or where the cameras for individual eyes are far enough away from each other to make everything look 3D. I find third-person games do this a lot better at the moment than first-person games. The only time it really breaks the game is where a 3D crosshair isn't supported, making the targeting in games impossible. Unreal Tournament 3, for example. The killing blow is that you have a choice between 3D and double the FPS, which can instead be put towards better graphics and gameplay related improvements. If anything, 3D would benefit older games more than it does new ones, breathing a new lease of life into them. Imagine Deus Ex in 3D with 32x anti-aliasing, if only 3D was supported. I will be mentioning the consoles a lot in this video, because like them or not, they are the baseline that game developers aim for when making games. They both contain custom processors at the moment, which make them incredibly difficult to compare to PCs in terms of power. But their graphics cards are the equivalent of a GeForce 7900 or Radeon 1900 series. If you look at this graph here, you'll see that computers have come on a long way since these. Most games today have a minimum requirement of a GeForce 8800 or Radeon 2900. This is because this is roughly how powerful the consoles are, plus a little bit more because PCs never seem to be as efficient at running games and they tend to run them at higher resolutions. Computer hardware is now many generations ahead of the consoles, as you can see from this list dating back to the year 2000. You can also see how large the gap is compared with between previous generations. The GeForce 9000 series was just a refresh of the 8000 series, the 200 series was a jump up, they skipped the 300 series completely for desktops, and since then have had three series, each more powerful than the last. It's about time they refresh the console hardware. Now for fun, I'm going to predict what the next generation of consoles will be like. I'm predicting that they're going to be a fair bit more powerful than today's consoles, since I don't see it worth Sony's or Microsoft's time to release a console that's hardly any more powerful than the last, especially since it will be powering games for the next 10 years or so. I wouldn't be surprised if they had a custom-made 8 or 16 core processor, where each core is significantly less powerful than the one in, say, your PC. This is based off the way they had a tri-core processor in current consoles, and how well it performed against dual-core PCs at that time. Who knows, AMD's method of having more cores may eventually pay off if they go down this route of optimizing games for large numbers of cores. Intel were experimenting with a 48-core processor a couple of years ago. There must be some kind of benefit to it. I see it as the most logical way to go, instead of trying to make a couple of cores as efficient as possible at crunching large amounts of data. I mean, what was the point in going multi-core in the first place? As for the graphics card, I've heard rumors that they will have a Radeon 7670, which I think would be a real disappointment if it was true. It would hardly be any more powerful than the current generation, possibly able to run today's games, but at full HD and with slightly better frame rates. A more powerful graphics card, or a dual graphics card option, would be far more beneficial. Most new processors have a graphics card built in. Although still fairly slow, they're getting better and may eventually be used in Crossfire with a separate graphics card to effectively double performance. If the next gen has dual graphics, I reckon it would be something along these lines. Going down this road would give AMD an advantage they desperately need over Intel right now. As for RAM, RAM is cheap and I hope that the next generation has as much of it as possible. Currently, the Xbox 360 and PlayStation 3 have 512 MB of RAM altogether, for both graphics and general use. This is a real limiting factor when it comes to textures in-game, and this is the one main area that current games could improve graphically. Chuck in 8GB and watch the detail in games go up, and the loading times go down. something that has been promised for a long time, yet doesn't seem to improve as new generations come out. Another hint at the power of the next generation consoles comes from the tech demos that are coming out for next generation engines. The Unreal 4 engine and Square Enix's are both running on a single GeForce 680. This suggests that this could be the baseline for the next generation of consoles. It would certainly be a big step up from the current consoles, what with the 680 being arguably the most powerful single graphics card in the world right now. Don't try to calculate what sort of spec they can fit into a £400 selling price, as I have no doubt that the sum of the hardware in the next generation of consoles will be more than their selling price initially. This happened with both the Xbox 360 and the PlayStation 3, and was done to make them as future-proof as possible. This explains this generation's extended life. I'm sure it will be the same with the next generation, and definitely hope that it's the case, since it will be the baseline hardware for new games to aim for until the next generation.